Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. So as announced, we are going ahead with the panel discussion on dengue fever. So like always, we are our esteemed panel in front of us. So Dr. Girish sir, he is the professor and head of Emergency Medicine Department, Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences. Welcome sir. And again Anil Kumar sir, he is again professor and head of Department of Microbiology. You are familiar with him. We have the last sepsis discussion, Anil sir was with us. And we have Dr. Rinoy, associate professor from General Medicine Department, and he is first to our channel. And we welcome Dr. Rinoy to ATCM. So without any further ado, myself, Dr. Srikrishnan, I am familiar to you. So without further delay, let's start the discussion. So we will start with Anil sir. Anil sir, there is a lot of confusion whenever we pronounce the terminology dengue, or whether it is to be called as dengue. So many a times what we usually does is that we have got this problem in saying exactly what is the pronunciation of dengue. So can you just clarify whether it is dengue or dengue? So let's start with you, sir.
That's a very valid question. As long as you get the message through that it's a viral infection, it is fine. You call it dengue or dengue, it's fine. So if you see the layman term, most of them call dengue because the spelling is such that we pronounce it such a way. But if you see the actual pronunciation, it's dengue.
Okay.
That's what they call. But hardly makes much of a difference as long as you convey that what is the disease the patient is infected with. So it's basically a viral infection which actually means a viral infection with hemorrhagic manifestation.
Okay.
Otherwise, dengue or dengue can be used interchangeably. Actually, it's dengue.
Okay.
But for our communication
purpose,
it doesn't matter if you call it dengue also.
Okay, sir. So, can you just elaborate what is the cause of dengue? Maybe I can say dengue now, maybe for the sake of discussion. Because I used to pronounce it as dengue fever. And when I say it to the layperson, usually dengue in our local region language. So, so what causes dengue and what are the common serotypes that we have come across, sir?
So, dengue is basically a viral infection, as we discussed. It's a flavivirus infection and it's transmitted by arthropods like mosquitoes. And having said that, there are many flyviral infections that is moving around in our environment. Especially in Kerala, we have all the flyvirus like Zika is there, dengue is there, dengue is there, then JE is there, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile, all these are flyviral infections. So we have a lot of flyviral infections. One among them is dengue, which is very common and comes as, it's hyperendemic. We are hyperendemic that we have this virus in our system, in our environment, and comes every year. We can't get rid of it because it is there as a reservoir in the arthropods and the human beings.
Okay.
So it's a infection is between the human and the mosquitoes. The mosquito gets infected by an infected human being. As long as an infected human being is around, the mosquitoes will get infected. And then there is another possibility that the mosquitoes once get infected is lifelong infected.
Okay.
So and it can also transmit vertically.
Okay.
Through their progeny, through their eggs.
Okay.
So there is a infection that is maintained in the mosquito population also.
Okay.
So even if you get rid of infections in human, the mosquito may
still
be
in
infected, still be infected, and they may still transmit the infections. And it's an RNA virus. It has got 4 serotypes. As of now, we will stay with 4 serotypes. There's a 5th serotype that the Philippines or the Malaysian people have identified, but it's not yet well characterized or well defined, so we don't go into that 5th serotype. For technical purpose, we'll say there are 4 serotypes. Very common in all over India, especially in Kerala. Dengue 1, 2, 3, 4, all are RNA viruses.
Okay, sir.
All differ from each other only 30% in the genome. So it's almost similar, but there is some difference between them. 30% of the genome is different between them. And dengue 2, 1, 3, or 4, which is seen in India, may not be the same that you see in the Latin American countries, Brazil or Americas. Because dengue 2 that you see in India would be quite different from the dengue 2 you see in the Latin American country.
Okay.
They have seen that the dengue 2 virus, which is nations, dengue 2 is far more, multiplies far more rapidly when compared to. So the pathogenicity will totally differ from the region you
go. Okay. Okay.
So there is difference between the dengue viruses between regions. Though we say dengue 1, 2, 3 and 4 are there. So there is difference between them.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that elaborative discussion. And now we'll to Dr. Rinoy. And next is a very tricky question because what is the 2009 WHO definition and classification of dengue? So can you just elaborate? There has been a lot of controversy. There are multiple definitions. So
I think before we go into 2009 guidelines and the classification, 1997 WHO had actually come out with something which said there is dengue fever, dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome. Okay. Dengue hemorrhagic fever was divided into 1 to 4 and 3 and 4 was actually classified as dengue shock syndrome.
Okay.
The problem there was actually too much of emphasis was given into the hemorrhagic component of it. Everybody was behind thrombocytopenia, forgetting that the major problem associated with dengue is a capillary leakage and plasma leakage leading on to the shock syndrome. Okay. So a shift from that and probably to emphasize the need for triaging, good disease surveillance and notification, I think dengue, the new guidelines actually came up in 2009. And this actually was given as dengue without warning symptoms, with warning symptoms, and then a severe dengue. Now, what are the warning signs or symptoms that are associated is actually intractable vomiting, abdominal pain or tenderness. When you examine if there is a hepatomegaly involved, is there any lethargy and actually slight impairment in consciousness or restlessness associated? Any fluid accumulation is there? Any mucosal bleeding is there? Or if there is a significant increase in the hematocrit and there is a rapid fall in the platelet. So these are the warning signs or symptoms that actually needs to be looked at and actually triaged accordingly. Okay. But the severe dengue is actually another thing where actually all these things are in severe format. That is actually there will be severe plasma leakage, severe hemorrhage, and also severe organ dysfunction. Actually, the organ dysfunction that is mentioned specifically is the transaminases more than 1,000, or if there is any obtundation of the neurological system in the form of drowsiness and coma and things like that. And finally, also any other organ dysfunction which includes probably heart and the other systems as such. So that is a major difference and change that has happened in 2009.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nai, for that, making us the correct definition, what is to be needed now. Now to Giri, sir, anyway, as per the newer definition, it is with dengue with warning sign, without warning sign. But still, we are very much use this terminology of dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome. Okay. Can you just elaborate that, sir?
Like Dr. Nair told, now our focus should be towards shock. Because according to all guidelines, we have hemorrhagic fever, we have shock syndrome. But what we routinely see in our practice, any fever for that matter, you take any other fever, shock is one of the common presentation. In dengue especially because of the vascular leak, shock is very, very common. So shock is one of the most important finding in dengue. But according to the definition, what you ask is hemorrhagic fever and shock, dengue shock. Hemorrhagic fever can occur due to various reasons. Like one of the common reasons what we see in our patients, there will be slight drop in platelets in all dengue fever. But in some subset of patients, a large amount of platelet drop can be there. Maybe it is less than 20,000, 10,000. They can bleed. That is one of the cause for bleed. But again, some patients can have prolonged APTT, PTANR. They also can bleed. So ultimately, all this mechanism, intravascular coagulation, intravascular thrombosis, all these things ultimately lead to a state of hemorrhagic fever.
Okay.
But we are seeing only a small amount of thrombocytopenia or hemorrhagic tendencies. But in a patient who is massively infected with the dengue virus or dengue virus, they can present with hemorrhagic fever first itself. So that is hemorrhagic fever. Patient come with high degree fever, joint pains, bleeds into the eyes, bleeds into the brain, wherever bleed can occur, and ultimately patient can develop hypotension because of bleed and complications of bleeding in various areas. Shock syndrome is slightly different. Shock syndrome can occur at any stage of dengue. Like the doctor now told, it is very, very common, but according to definition, if you see class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4 is actually shock. But what we routinely see is class 4 occurs much earlier than any other complication. So class 4 is very, very important. This shock is very important because vascular leak occurs first itself in dengue. You can see whenever blood vessels are like small holes will be formed in the blood vessel, the volume which is in the intravascular compartment can leak out, especially albumin or protein can leak out. Then along with the protein, the whole fluid also will go out. So that creates a problem in the intravascular compartment. There will be intravascular fluid deficiency. Patient can develop hypotension, shock, all these things. So
So ultimately, when we are treating a patient of dengue, this is very important, because platelet, drop in platelet, all these things, we'll get some time to treat. We can analyze the platelet every 6 hours, we see what happens to the platelet, the story drops. But whereas in shock, it acutely present. Patient present with acute shock, and we'll have to immediately manage. For an emergency doctor, shock is more most important than hemorrhagic thing. Like Dr. Renner told, it is most important thing. That's why the shift has occurred from hemorrhagic fever to shock.
Shocks.
But if you see the guidelines, it is 1, 2, 3, 4. Like first is mild fever, then hemorrhage, then some hypotension. Last is shock. It is not like that. Most of the patient, what we see, shock comes first itself.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Dear audience, so your questions will be answered. So whatever be there, you just type in your chat box. We have some pre-planned questions. We have some 20 pre-planned questions. We have covered 3. So after this, majority of them will be covered in this pre-planned questions, the majority of your doubt. And whatever it is, please type it in your chat box. We will be taking that at the end of the sessions. Now, coming back to again to Anil sir. So we are very commonly using this terminology of secondary dengue infection by different virus serotypes. Can you just elaborate?
Dengue fever is a very unique infection in the sense that there are 4 serotypes that I have discovered, that I have discussed before. And there is something called as an original antigenic sin. That this, when you have multiple serotypes of the same virus, you have a phenomenon called as only original antigenic sin. That is, you get infected with one serotype and it doesn't protect you from the other serotype. In fact, it becomes worse if the other serotype comes. So that is the immunology of dengue. That is the big bottleneck for making an effective vaccine also. The vaccines are also dangerous in the sense that they can produce this particular phenomenon. This is called as antibody dependent enhancement. So what happens is, the immunology of dengue says that you get infected by either dengue 1 or dengue 2 or dengue 3 or dengue 4, whatever is prevalent in your environment. But primary infection rarely produces any symptoms. It's mostly asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. It doesn't cause any dengue, hemorrhagic fever or shock. So primary infection goes unnoticed. Out of the 390 million infections that we see, most of them are asymptomatic. Only 96 million are only symptomatic, and only 2 million becomes hemorrhagic or shock syndrome goes away. So once you get infected, the patient develops antibodies against that particular serotype. And these antibodies are two types, heterotypic and homotypic. The heterotypic will protect from other serotypes for a short duration, for 2 years. Beyond 2 years, it is only homotypic, that is, you are protected against the virus serotype, that is, you are getting infected. So you are getting infected with dengue serotype 1. Your protection will be lifelong for dengue serotype 1 only. But for other serotype, protection would be only for 2 to 3 years. As the days go by, as the years go by after having infection, the chances of getting dengue hemorrhagic fever increases because your neutralizing antibodies go down. Only non-neutralizing antibodies are there. These non-neutralizing antibodies will bind with the dengue secondary infection. That is, you get infected again with a different serotype. That could be dengue 3, 4 or anything, or dengue 2. So you get infected, the virus and antibody complex, that is non-neutralizing antibody complex, will go and bind to the Fc receptor containing cells like macrophages, and then enhances the multiplication of the virus.
Okay.
It gets entry into the cells and multiplies profusely. So that is antibody dependent enhancement. Antibody enhances the multiplication of the next serotype. This is called a secondary dengue.
Okay, sir.
This is what that is dangerous, that leads to your dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome.
Okay. Can you just quickly tell the incubation period part also,
sir? Incubation is 4 to 7 days. It may range to 14 days also. 4 to 7 days is the average of incubation period where you patient develops the symptoms.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now, again to Giri, sir. Sir, have we heard about any other modes of transmission rather than from mosquitoes?
Routinely, we don't see it. Anil sir will be a better person to answer that. Routinely, we don't see it in clinical practice.
Vertical transmission.
But it can happen. See, viremia phase, anything can happen. If you are getting a needle stick injury, it can transmit. If you are getting a blood transfusion which is given immediately from a dengue viremic patient, it can happen. Because primary infection is asymptomatic. You don't know. The patient coming for blood donation may not have any symptoms in the first place. And there is no protocol to screen for dengue in blood donation. So there it can happen. Organ donation, it can happen. Then you have vertical transmission. Very rarely it happens, but vertical transmission can.
Is a possibility.
And even splash on the mucous membrane of a patient who is infected and viremic with dengue can happen. But these are very rare phenomena. But documented cases of dengue by blood transfusion has occurred. And there are cases.
Just like transfusion malaria, what we have.
It will be very less.
With with more and more dengue infection coming in the population, primary dengue may not be identified during blood donation.
Okay.
So there you can have a possibility. We had one case probable of transmission dengue in a liver transplantation.
Okay. Okay,
it
sir.
It has been published.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Now coming back to Dr. Ranoy, so what are the key points that we need to do when we see a patient in respect to the history and the physical examination?
Yeah, I think I would like to answer this question based on actually the phases of the illness.
Yes.
Actually, that would be the ideal way.
Yes.
Because I think every postgraduate or undergraduate should be trained to look at the onset of symptoms and identify the phase.
Yes.
In which the patient is in. The phases are basically briefly divided into three. One is a febrile phase, the other one is a critical phase, and the recovery phase.
Okay.
So in the febrile phase, at least in the initial febrile phase, it's very difficult to distinguish from any other acute febrile illness.
Okay.
Some salient features are a retrobital pain or probably some skin kind of a congestion and things like that, which could be actually more in dengue. But having said that, this could be also seen in other hemorrhagic fevers also. But retrobital pain has been said to be specific. Another thing that is there in the febrile phase is sometimes the fever can resolve and the classical saddleback pattern can occur, where fever will not be there for 2 days and there could be a recurrence of fever, which again lasts for about 2 to 3 days. Tunicate test probably will be useful at this stage, probably towards the last phase, to see whether there is any features associated.
Okay.
In the critical phase is where I think we have to be really looking at all the warning signs and symptoms have to be looked at and asked by the physician who actually sees such a patient. And also another few thing is the compensated shock. Like sir was mentioning, Agrisa was mentioning about 3 and 4, and 4 is actually shock. The third part is actually the compensated shock. I think as a physician, you should be able to actually pick that up. We should train the students to pick that up. Where the pulse pressure actually narrows, there could be postural tachycardia or a postural hypotension. I think we should be able to pick that thing much more. The last phase or a recovery phase and the febrile phase usually occurs, can range anywhere between 1 to 7 days. And the critical phase is between about 3 or 4 days to off symptom onset to about 7 days. So after that, it is actually the recovery phase. And the recovery phase, usually patient becomes better. There's a general feeling of well-being that actually comes in. But certain peculiar things that we have seen in these phases actually developing of an asymptomatic bradycardia.
Okay.
That means the heart rate can actually go down. Patients do complain of a new onset rash, probably on the 6th or 7th day sometimes, or even significant pruritus without rash. This is constantly complained by patients during the recovery phase from this one. So this is an important thing. And another important thing is if there has been an overzealous use of fluids, patients can go into respiratory distress because of the fluid overload. So at that particular point, this is to be looked at and actually monitored very well. And the last part of it is there are a lot of atypical symptoms and features or unusual features that are associated with dengue. And WHO has actually clubbed it under expanded dengue syndrome.
Okay.
So that actually encompasses a lot of things where organ involvement, which are usually unusual. If you say a GB syndrome associated or a rhabdomyolysis, which is not usually associated with dengue, can actually present like that. So such things, as well as co-infections with malaria, sepsis, bacterial sepsis, all those things are actually common things that have been noted because of probably a transient immunosuppression at that particular time. And this needs to be actually focused on. So expanded dengue syndrome is actually gaining a lot of popularity.
So the key message that we need to give is that picking up that hypotension,
yes,
when the patient coming to the emergency room, as you correctly mentioned, the postural hypotension, when you look at the initially the BP will be normal, but you need to go for the initial postural hypotension, postural tachycardia, narrowing of the pulse pressure, then only the tachycardia and hypotension will happen. So that phase that we need to pick will be the key message.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Now again, Dr. Rana has just touched upon it, but can you just elaborate on it, sir, on tourniquet test and its relevance? Lot of primary practitioners are watching this.
In a tertiary care center like this, where we can do the testing very fast, within 15 minutes we are getting information, tourniquet test does not have any clinical relevance. But if you see the larger area in India, larger primary care centers in India, this is very, very important because we are unable to do the routine CBC or platelet count immediately. We take some time, 6 hours to 12 hours. There it is very important. Tourniquet test is very, very simple test. Just tie the BP cuff and inflate the BP cuff. Just keep the pressure in between systolic and diastolic. Wait for 5 minutes. Then look at the area in that cubital area. you can see more than 10 to 20 petechial rashes in that time, in 1 inch square area. Then that is a diagnostic feature of some platelet dysfunction or bleeding tendency or this. Some books have mentioned HESS test also. The name for this test is HESS test. But many books have given just tourniquet test. Whatever it is, it's a very simple test. We can do it. We can pick up this problem early. This can also be done in other platelet disorders or bleeding disorders. There also it will be positive. So it is not specific for dengue, but it is specific for many bleeding diseases, including dengue, hemorrhagic fever, including dengue. It's a very easy test. We can do it. But nowadays in bigger hospitals where the platelet count get in within
30 minutes,
it may not be very important. But as a student, MBBS student, or a primary physician who is working in a clinic, this is very, very important. They can easily diagnose dengue, hemorrhagic fever first itself.
Periphery itself. Thank you, sir. We'll come to next to Anil sir again. So again, the testing part of dengue, sir, there are a lot of what test to be sent, what whether it's an antigen, whether IgG, IgM, NS1, a lot of confusion regarding this. So can you just clarify it, sir?
So it depends on the place where the patient lands. So as sir said, peripheral centers, you don't have much of facility, and peripheral centers are the one who sees the patient initially.
Sir.
In centers like ours, they come when it is really bad. It's an hemorrhagic center. That's more than 2 weeks or more than 1 week. So ideally, if you go by the weeks, in the first week, since RT-PCR is available now everywhere, they can always use an RT-PCR system to diagnose the dengue in the first week itself. Using an RT-PCR, the same RT-PCR that is used for COVID, but you have to use a different set of primers and reagents if it is available. An RT-PCR is the best way to diagnose the first week. Beyond, and the first week itself, you can go for NS1 antigen. NS1 antigen stays beyond first week. So after 12-14 days, you can do an NS1 antigen. Okay. NS1 antigen is diagnostic, and RT-PCR is diagnostic of primary infection.
Okay.
By default, you can confirm that this is a case of a primary dengue case or a dengue infection, not a primary or secondary, it could be dengue infection. Primary or secondary, we can determine later only. Then after the first week, go for an IgM, after the first week only. An IgM peaks between 2 to 4 weeks and remains there for at least 3 months.
Okay.
So an isolated IgM does not indicate
anything.
So as sir has already told you that you have to have a clinical acumen to diagnose this is a case of dengue. Don't order the dengue test just because you feel like ordering. Just if you have a high index of suspicion, only order, because IgM will come after 40 days. And primary dengue infection is very common, asymptomatic, people must be having it, antibodies must be there. So IgM can be done after 1 week, but lingers. If you don't have clinical symptoms, don't consider it a case of dengue. IgG is useful only to diagnose, to differentiate between primary and secondary dengue if you do it together with IgM.
Okay.
In our hospital, we do IgG and IgM together, so that we get to get an IgG-IgM ratio.
Okay.
And people have documented that more than 1.1 of IgG-IgM ratio indicates a secondary dengue infection.
Okay.
Because if you have a secondary infection, IgG comes fast.
First.
In a primary infection, IgG won't come after, it comes only after 14 days.
Fine.
So ideally, you go for an RT-PCR in the first week, an NS1 in the first week. After 12 days or 14 days, you can do an NS1, you can do an IgM, provided you have a clinical features of dengue. IgM alone can be positive, and it can be used as a diagnostic test for dengue. An IgG-IgM ratio, if you want to do, you can use for characterizing whether primary
or secondary infection. Okay, so the message is clear. The initial week, the test that we need to do will be the PCR, if you have availability. Otherwise, go with NS1. Then later on, the second week, you can go for your IgM. And we have a panel like what we did, we can compare with the IgG also.
And if you are doing an NS1, go for an ELISA-based NS1.
Okay.
ELISA is more sensitive. But if you have a rapid card test for NS1, that is also good, but you should take it with a pinch of salt because it's not that sensitive.
Sensitive.
ELISA would be more sensitive.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now we'll come back to Dr. Rama. Can we just quickly elaborate what are the investigations that we need to send? So we have discussed regarding the serological investigation. Now, rest.
So the routine investigations specifically are all, most important one is the complete blood count.
Okay.
And here also, I think when we look at it, everybody is actually behind the platelets, but ideally you should be behind the hemoglobin and the hematocrit.
Okay.
So a 20% increase in the hematocrit over the baseline value or according to the age and sex of that particular person is something that has to be taken into consideration. Another thing is that leukopenia is something which actually occurs early in the febrile phase itself, and probably that is the first thing to recover, after which the platelet recovery follows.
Okay.
But as usual, I think everywhere, I think the platelet count is the maximum importance that is actually being given there. So I think that part has to be discouraged. Otherwise, I think peripheral smear is a good investigation, because initial phase, sometimes you might miss out on any hematological malignancy and things like that, but patients can present with a fever. And we have seen so many cases being referred as probable suspected dengue, and it turns out to be something else. So I think a peripheral smear is a good test to do. Kidney function and liver function. Liver function, if there is a resource restraint, at least an SGOT and SGPT are something which we have to look at. Why I said renal function is because most of, and probably a CK also. Why is because I think in our situation, whenever there is a problem, especially during rainy season or around rainy season, we are also seeing an increased leptospirosis. So a CK and a renal dysfunction would probably more favor towards leptospirosis rather than dengue fever. And SGOT, SGPT, again, the usual elevation is about 2 to 5 times.
Okay.
If anything more than that, either it is an atypical form of presentation of dengue, or alternative diagnosis actually ideally have to be looked at. I think more than this, I don't think, see, there might be variations anywhere. Like if you look at the APDT, it might be prolonged. But those have not got significant therapeutic implications. So I feel this is what you should actually restrict to. And if there are any organ-specific atypical findings, obviously you have to investigate accordingly.
That okay.
I would like to add one.
Yes, sir. Please.
As Dr. Rina had said, leptospirosis is a differential illness, and you have very well used that tropical fever panel to differentiate leptospirosis and dengue. Since we have the access to the tropical fever panel, which is multiplex PCR, RT-PCR, you can always go ahead with that to rule out dengue and leptospirosis can come in.
Okay.
Even malaria is there in that.
In that, okay.
So you can rule out technically all the tropical fever.
Tropical fever.
No, that's a very good test.
Okay. And again, one more doubt in my mind is that the CBC platelet, that automated platelets, what is your take on it? Whether we need to relay on that?
Yeah, that's why I said peripheral smear also as an additional thing, but however said and then, the problem associated with automation is that a giant platelet or a clumped platelet probably will be taken as only one.
Yes.
Giant platelet might have a better efficiency even though the platelet count is low. Some patients have giant platelets. The other one, much more important in this case, is actually clumped platelets.
Yes.
So if there are six platelets clumped together, the counter will actually take it as only one. And the platelet count will be definitely lower. So that is something that you have to take with a pinch of salt, and probably when there's a clinical suspicion, definitely order for a peripheral smear or look at a smear yourself and then count it. That would be ideal.
That is the one thing, because a lot of automation has come. We feel that once the platelets start improving, we'll thought of discharging the patient, and suddenly the platelet count is dropping and we are panicked, but the patient is clinically stable. And sometimes it's a borderline case, we are in a mind whether to give transfusion or not. So just wanted to clarify that. And again, coming back to Dr. Rinai, can you just let us know who all needs admission? Who all needs admission to the ward or maybe to the ICU, or they can be managed as an OPB? So how will you categorize?
Yeah, so I think WHO has already made it very easy for me according to these particular questions, because without warning, with warning and severe.
Yes.
So without warning, definitely directly can be managed in the OPD. With warning symptoms, definitely. Ideally, an admission would be required, especially if there are comorbid illnesses and other things like that. A subset can be probably still managed in the OPD according to the physician's confidence. But the severe dengue has to be managed in a HDU or an ICU. But having said that, I think host factors as well as virus factors need to be looked at it. The virus factors which I am trying to mention is actually, like already mentioned, if there is a secondary infection that is actually evident when we do the combination of NS1, IgM and IgG, then I think that those patients have to be given a little bit more importance, definitely, because they can actually worsen faster. Host factors, definitely it is a comorbid illnesses, the age, the extremes of the age, especially infants as well as elderly population, pregnant women, patients who have other comorbid illnesses like diabetes, renal dysfunctions, any hemoglobinopathy or hemolytic sort of an anemia, malignancy, immunosuppression, all those things definitely has to be given more priority. One important thing that I would say is actually whenever you have a patient who comes with dengue and you're assessing for whether to admit or not to admit, one thing is whether this particular patient can take orally.
Okay.
Can the patient have facility, or patient is educated enough to monitor his output? This, I think, are two important things that you have to look at. Because if oral, if significant vomiting and things are there, then I think more volume depletion occurs and it can complicate the already occurring plasma leakage that is there.
Okay.
So if the patient is able to take orally without vomiting and other things like that, definitely in that subset, even with warnings, symptoms or sign, we can probably actually manage in the OPD. But this is something left to the physician's confidence. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. That clarify, because it all depends upon which center you are practicing, whether you have enough beds to admit this group of patients, and if the patient is demanding again and they can't come, maybe they are coming from a far off place and there is no proper monitoring system along with the comorbidity, that will give us an idea.
Yes.
But WHO has given us a guideline whom to admit, but severe dengue there is no doubt to admit, but those category group of patients where we can plus or minus manage in the OPD, we can do that. Thank you, Dr. Nayagir. So now coming to Giri sir, so we have been using this terminology plasma leakage. So can you just elaborate on this?
So when we talk about dengue or any sepsis case, there is plasma leakage that is actually producing all the problems in dengue. But how to diagnose it, like Dr. Nair told, hematocrit, that is one of the easiest thing we can do in emergency room or in any settings, any even peripheral settings we can see. When the hemoconcentration occurs, sudden leakage produces concentration, whether it is trauma, dengue, any shock, the hematocrit will increase. More than 20% increase or after fluid reduction of more than 20% will tell you that the patient is having significant volume loss. Here dengue, it is due to vascular leak. Why vascular leak occurs is there will be small fenestration or holes in the blood vessels due to dengue, sepsis, malaria, all these conditions we can get it. Through that, water or blood or blood products may go out. So intravascular volume will come down. Mainly plasma is going out. So you can see the albumin also. Many patients in dengue fever or dengue fever, you can see the albumin will be low. That is one of the another important clue whether the patient is going to shock or not. When the albumin is less, you know that albumin holds the fluid. When the albumin goes out, the fluid also will go out. So albumin, low albumin, high hematocrit will give a lab clue for the shock syndrome or plasma leakage. Then we are examining the patient already. Dr. Rina told there will be tachycardia. But remember that some dengue patients can have bradycardia. So that may be masked. Patients on beta blocker, calcium channel blockers, that also masked. So tachycardia, sometimes it will not give a clue. Postural hypotension is another important thing. And postural tachycardia, both things are very important, but we have to understand that most of these patients may not be able to stand, so we don't have that option also. So next option is raising the passive leg raising test. That easily can be done in emergency room. Just raise the leg, so the amount of fluid which is there in the peripheries may shift to the central circulation. If the BP increases, off if there is a central line, the BP increases, then you can know that this patient may respond to fluid. Then if you have an ultrasound machine, you can see the IVC and see whether it is collapsible, fluid overload, all these things can be picked up. So that is another method. So all these methods are there. Even then clinical examination is very, very important. You are looking at the patient. Some patient may be fluid overloaded because they might have come from a different center, they might have given fluids, but still in shock. Shock may be due to something else. It can be due to hypoadrenalism. Adrenal shock also can occur in dengue. So various mechanisms are there, but always we have to make out whether there is intravascular volume loss, then only we have to give fluid. Suppose you don't know all these things, you give fluid and wait. If the patient develops pulmonary edema, then the patient is in fluid overload, you can treat with Lasix or furosemide. That is only the last option. If you don't have anything, the patient is still in shock, wherever you are working, then fluid is the first choice. If the fluid does not work, then only we have to go for norepinephrine or some other anotropes like that. Otherwise, in any emergency room, passive leg raising test will be very easy test. We can do it and we can pick up. Other signs are all are good, but some patients we will not be able to do that. Ultrasound will not be available in all emergency room. Echo also will not be available in all emergency room. So passive leg raising test will be very easy thing which any physician can do.
Sir, again with the similar, the same contest, what will be our initial treatment plan in terms of supportive care, volume resuscitation? When, suppose we have a dengue patient in front of us in the ER.
So whenever a patient comes to emergency room, it is always airway, breathing, circulation, where whichever may be the patient. So airway should be proper because many patients will be unconscious or patients will be in shock. There will be a lot of secretions. We have to clear all these things. Airway should be cleared. Then circulation, we already told that there is significant vascular leak in dengue, but any other fever you take, there also vascular leak is there or volume loss is there, volume has to be replaced. So first put two IV lines. Any patient who is having dengue or any shock, two IV lines is a mandatory thing. Then we can give fluid. Normal saline is the best fluid for all patients because it is available everywhere. If you see the physiological solution, best physiological solution is regular lactate. But normal saline can be given here. 20 to 30 ml per kg body weight. That is the initial bolus. When we are giving initial bolus, only thing we have to observe the patient. Some patients can go to pulmonary edema even if they are not in volume overload, because already Rina has told there will be like ARDS like features can be there. So if you give more fluid, sometimes this patient can go to pulmonary edema features. So you have to monitor the patient. 20 to 30 ml normal saline can be given. The best marker for reperfusion will be urine output.
Okay.
Other markers are there like lactate. In emergency room, we use lactate. We know that whenever there is hypotension, lactate will
increases.
Be elevated because of anaerobic mechanism. When we give fluid, if the intravascular volume increases, then the lactate will come down. That is called as lactate clearance. But a normal doctor who is working in periphery, if there is a good urine output, that's a good sign. So that has to be maintained. So give fluid, patient's BP should be maintained, then patient should have good urine output. There are a lot of other clinical parameters which can check during the reperfusion, but in a normal settings, all these things are not available. So urine output will be very best. So you give fluid, that is one thing. Next one is paracetamol. Whether to give paracetamol or not, that is a very important question. Patient who are symptomatic because of fever, paracetamol should be given. Paracetamol should not be given as an anti-inflammatory drug. In most of the conditions, we give paracetamol as an anti-inflammatory or anti-fever medicine. So if the patient is symptomatic, like a patient is having high degree fever, discomfort, then paracetamol can be given. Otherwise, unnecessarily giving paracetamol is not good because some of these patients can have liver injury also. So if required, give paracetamol. Don't put it as 3 times, 4 times continuously. Don't completely mask the fever, because a clinician like Dr. Rina may like to see what is the pattern of fever, because this dengue can be associated with malaria, leptospira, so many things. So a physician may like to see what is the pattern of fever at least for 24 hours. So do not completely suppress the fever. Patient discomfort has to be
reduced.
That is the main treatment in emergency room.
Sir, any role for antibiotics? That is again...
It's a virus. Antibiotic does not have any role in dengue fever. But if the patient in ICU after few days, patient can develop some secondary infection like aspiration pneumonia or IV line infection, then only antibiotics are required. Otherwise, antibiotics are not required in dengue fever.
With the clinically proven dengue or serologically proven dengue, definitely you doesn't need any antibiotics.
We don't use. But what happens is most of the emergency areas, doctors will try to start antibiotic initially. It has to be de-escalated or stopped once you know that it is dengue. If the diagnosis is very clear, immediately we have to stop.
Maybe there is an overlap of leptospirosis and malaria in that area. So depends upon their endemic city, we can decide.
Many doctors give cocktail treatment initially. They give multiple drugs. Once you get the proper diagnosis, immediately discontinue.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Now the most important question, whenever we discuss about dengue, the question arises in our mind is when to give platelets. So, what is the indications for platelet?
This is very controversial because everybody sees it differently. But most of the studies have clearly mentioned that prophylactic platelet transfusion is actually not going to make any significant difference, even in severe thrombocytopenia. That means thrombocytopenia less than 50,000 also, you do not give. But then as a physician who is actually treating, it becomes little risky. At platelet counts less than 20,000 or even less than 10,000. Earlier 20,000, now I think we are a little bit more comfortable at 10,000. But because that is when spontaneous bleed can anyway occur. So we, if we are not actually supplementing them, then will there be a litigation that comes if there is a major bleed? That is something which is there in everybody's mind. So I don't know how to address that particular issue. There are no clear-cut rules that are there. But WHO has mentioned something like grading of hemorrhages, and grade 2 hemorrhages, that is actually if a patient is having any internal bleed in the form of hemoptysis, hematemesis, patient has having melena, hematochezia, all those things definitely require this. Those are grade 2 bleeding. Or if there is intramuscular bleeding, intracranial suspicion of intracranial bleed, and all these areas, including if a menstrual bleed where there is more than two pads being used, and severe mucosal bleeds or ecchymotic patches which are more than 10 centimeters, all those things definitely come under the grade 2 class, and ideally it should be this one. So the concept is less is more. That means even though the platelet count is actually really less, it doesn't mean that platelets are dysfunctional. And the bleeding is obvious in all cases is not a must. So I think it is important to understand that particular concept. And WHO and all of the other guidelines have really mentioned that it is more that the plasma leakage that it should be given importance and not just the absolute platelet count.
Okay. Yeah. So that clarifies. So you see the patient clinically, and if there is evidence of any hemorrhage, as you said, in the class 2 bleed, definitely there is an indication to transfuse platelets. Yes. Unless and until, if we can wait till 10,000, yeah, we are happy to wait till 10,000. If it drops beyond 10,000, definitely warrants for a platelet transfusion because the chance of spontaneous bleed is high. Yes. So that will be the time. Again, one thing is that lot of female patients, as you said, menstrual bleeding, usually maybe some due to the hormonal disturbances, they will get this infection. So when they are getting admitted, usually they will come in their menstrual cycle. So we see a lot of patients with dengue getting their during their periods getting infected with dengue. So that again, more than two pads per day, that warrants again for a transfusion with platelets.
Actually, there was an interesting editorial which I have read long time back.
Okay.
I don't know whether further studies have come out of it, in from Vellore, where they said that actually there could be an ADAMTS13 deficiency.
Okay.
And ideally you should be giving either an FFP cryo if you are transfusing, okay, with platelet prior to that.
Okay.
Otherwise what is going to happen is there is going to be significant clumping and clotting and things like that can happen. But further studies, I'm not sure whether it is really available.
Okay, so we need more evidences, yeah, more on the evidences on that aspect. Okay, thank you. Now again to the another $1 million question in dengue, sir, use of steroids and anti-D immunoglobulin, sir. Most importantly, steroids, sir. Okay. Giri, sir.
So, steroids, we know that if you see older books, steroids, there are a lot of controversies. Some book says you give steroids, some book says you don't give steroids. If you take WHO guidelines, CDC guidelines, steroid, they're telling it is not of much use. But if you see the mechanism of thrombocytopenia, there will be some antibodies which is there in the platelets or RBCs that go to the spleen. Spleen will detect these antibodies or external factor, then kill the platelet or RBCs. That is the action occurs inside body. So some physicians believe that when we give steroids, this mechanism can be avoided and platelet can improve. But WHO clearly says, or CDC clearly says, it is not indicated. So I cannot comment that it can be indicated, but some patients, what we have given initial phase, it's, we can see there is no significant drop has occurred in the platelet count. But later phases, steroids will not be very helpful because they are already sets in that immune phase has gone. Like you take MISC or ARDS, all these things now steroids have got some role. But at present, steroids are not indicated. But many physicians still give the steroids. Some physicians tell that it is beneficial, but as such, it is not indicated. It cannot be advised from a medical college like this. So that is that.
And again, with associated complication, as sir mentioned, macrophage activation syndrome.
In that conditions, like somebody develops macrophage activation syndrome, ARDS, then this can be indicated.
Okay.
Or patient is having asthmatic episode. Many patients can have that can be given.
Maybe Dr. Rana, you had few experience with macrophage activation syndrome, dengue associated.
I think the hyperferritinemia should not be taken as hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. Most of these patients, because it's an acute phase reactant, hyperferritinemia is seen. Because in the definition of HLH also, more than 500 is considered as this one. But more than 500, most of the time, when in most of acute infections, you are seeing. So most of the time, physicians are using just hyperferritinemia to give
As a single,
marker to give steroids, which I am not favoring. But otherwise, definitely, like if a clear-cut HLS is there, other features are fitting in, definitely steroids has a significant role. Like I just adding on to what sir has said, I think the mechanism of thrombocytopenia in dengue is not very clear. That is where the whole problem lies. I mean, people are saying there is a transient bone marrow suppression. There is a destruction because of the antibody-mediated, complement-mediated things. There's a consumption that is happening. So all those things are postulations. I think the destruction part is where the probably the steroids and probably to an extent the transient suppression part. where that will act the most. So unless and until that is very clear and basic sciences actually lead us to a better understanding of that, I don't think we can.
Only if there are other indications to use of steroids, we are indicating. Otherwise, for a routine dengue patient that is coming to us.
Or we should probably do an RCT, properly blind and do it.
We cannot recommend it. Yeah. If the RCT is done, then if we have good results, then we can recommend. The other thing, IMDD, which is basically used in pregnancy. And later it was now it can be used in ITP also, like eltrombopag also used in ITP. Here also it was tried. Some good results are there, some favorable papers are there. 250 international units per kg is the dose. But we have never used it because we have we routinely follow the guidelines, international guidelines.
Evidence-based practice.
There it is not recommended, but there are a lot of papers which is favoring this anti-D treatment. Now it may come in a big way, sometimes it may come, but the dose is slightly higher, cost factor may be
a significant
problem in India.
Next most important, whenever the patient get admitted to the ED or to the ward, the common question that they will lot have, this WhatsApp university, they'll get a lot of information and they will come and start asking, can I give this? And what is the role of this papaya leaf, karikaya extract, and any diet that needed to be considered at the during the time of dengue?
I think there is no harm in actually giving the natural papaya and things like that, or any fruit like pomegranate and things like that. Don't know whether that will cause any difference, but a placebo effect, I don't mind them taking that. The leaf extract prepared commercially, what is it used to stabilize that particular thing, we are not very sure. And another thing is that it fixes, it shifts the focus. Our focus is plasma leakage, preventing complications. The focus shifts to one ottamuli. That is, if you give this, nothing else needs to be. So fluid intake and fluid things are completely forgotten. Now going back into the studies, I just went through something with a meta-analysis done by Rajapakshe et al. With about 9 studies, finally after their screening process were looked at, predominantly from India, 6 from India and others from Southeast Asian regions. They said there is absolutely no use of this particular extract, at least now, and more thing can come. So what is the mechanism of action? It's an antioxidant. That's the only thing they are saying, nothing else. It can have some antiviral effect or something like that, is something that has been postulated. But unless and until the basic sciences tell you that research, further research tells you that this is actually what is causing it, we cannot advocate it in the general practice.
Right.
And one major study, which was a multicentric study that was done in India, I forgot the name, Kasturi et al. Or something, which actually gave 1100 milligram of that for 3 days. There was no significant adverse effects rather than mild nausea and vomiting. Significant improvement is what they claim. But the biggest thing is they are not looking at patients who have severe dengue or significant warning signs. They are taking a safe route of actually using it only in that particular period where people are actually not having significant symptoms. The final thing is a personal observation. People who have started early, I have seen transaminitis going little bit more than the usual practice.
Okay.
Something which usually is less around 200, 300, it goes up a little bit more. I mean, not a significant number, but I have at least about 5 to 6 patients who went. They did not go into liver failure or any of the issues, spontaneously recovered. I do not know whether it is a part of a severe dengue also. It's just a mere observation that I have.
So again, we need a proper RCT.
Yes,
with
yes.
Proper patient selections. We have a severe dengue, we need to give, but natural go sets for the patient will start improving after 1 week.
Yes.
Whether it is due to this extract or we are not very sure. So definitely there is no harm as such, we have not seen any harm in giving this drug, but definitely we need more evidences.
Yeah. Don't fix the focus from fluid therapy. That's
the patient bystanders will be more concerned regarding the platelet count. So that is the question arises.
Yes.
So they wanted the numbers rather than the other part. Okay, thank you. Sir, again, Giri sir, what are the usual common complications that what you are seeing, sir?
Routinely, any viral fever you take, you can see some amount of STOT, STPT elevation. It is not liver injury, there will be some liver involvement. But some patients who in dengue fever, they can develop little more higher, like maybe 800, 700 STOT, STPT, may raise to 800, 700. But normally, they come back to normal within 1 week. Okay. Then creatinine, normally in dengue fever, it will not be elevated. if creatinine is elevating, one reason is it can be due to fluid deficit. Another reason we have to see for another differential diagnosis like leptospirosis. In our country now Handa virus is coming, there also you can get elevated creatinine. That is another thing. So liver function test, this one. Platelet count, already Dr. Runga explained that the platelet count can be dropped, patient can have bleeding tendencies. Patients who are on aspirin, many patients are on aspirin. So even if there is a drop in platelets, sometimes the function of platelet may be deficit. So some patients can bleed. Then encephalitis can present in some patient. Some patients can have GP syndrome, neuropathies can present. So many, any complication can occur. Some patients can have bradycardia. It is explained that it may be due to involvement of myocardium or the sinus node. So both are postulated. So that can occur. And all organs, like some patients can have pleural effusion because of a hypoalbuminemia or a fluid overload, can have myositis is common in some patients. So all types of complications are there. But creatinine elevation is not typically seen in dengue fever. If creatinine elevation is seen in early phase itself, you have to think about a differential diagnosis. Or you correct the fluid deficit, if the creatinine improves, then that's okay. So these are the routine complications, but rarely patients go to complication. Shock is a major complication.
Major complication.
And all complications may be secondary to shock.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
But people
sir.
With underlying disease may present differently. Yeah. CLD case.
Associated with the dengue.
Yeah.
Sir, again to Anil sir, what is the status of vaccine, sir? Please let us.
Vaccine, as I said, original antigenic sin is the biggest bottleneck. The pre-existing antibodies may amplify. So if you give a vaccine in a naive patient who has not experienced dengue, then the antibodies can amplify. It has known to be amplified. So there are different vaccines. The one which has been licensed in 2015 is Sanofi Pasteur's vaccine, and it was immediately implemented in Philippines. And Philippines went very well, and they implemented in the children, and immediately they found antibody-dependent enhancement and a lot of complicated dengue cases coming post-vaccination. And they just stopped it. They banned the vaccine and they stopped it. And then people realized that this vaccine can produce problem, like same way that secondary dengue produces. So then they gave a, now it has come back. The vaccine is approved in many countries, and it is with a catch that the patient should be serologically positive for dengue.
Okay.
Any person who is serologically positive and has got demonstrable IgG antibodies by ELISA or a rapid card test, if you have a highly endemic area, card test is good enough, is eligible for getting a vaccine.
Okay.
So if you give that vaccine, it's a tetravalent vaccine. The backbone of the vaccine is a yellow fever virus.
Okay.
It's based on the yellow fever virus. The antigens have been tweaked and you put the dengue antigens in it. And then the vaccine is given in 3 doses every 6 months. That is 1 whole year you have to give that vaccine. And then it has got some amount of protection against severe dengue, 50-60% efficacy is there. But the patient should be serologically positive.
Positive.
And depends on how robust your test is.
Okay.
If your test gives false positive, then again. So that is the approved vaccine that is available. There are other 2 vaccines which are based on live attenuated dengue viruses, that all 4 serotypes by NIH. And that is in phase 3 clinical trial.
Okay.
So there is an inherent danger of giving vaccine to serologically negative patients, that they may develop antibody develop enhancement, as dengue shock syndrome or dengue hemorrhagic fever if they suffer a dengue subsequently.
Okay. Is it available in India, sir? No.
It's not available.
It's not approved
in India.
Okay, sir.
It's approved just in a few countries.
Countries.
Where there is high endemicity and they are ready to take this risk. It's a big problem if people end up with trouble with vaccination.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Now, the most important thing we have discussed regarding vaccine and we have discussed regarding everything treatment, the most key cornerstone of the management of dengue, I think it is the preventive aspects. So, can you, Dr. Rana, can you just quickly tell what should be the preventive aspect?
Yeah, predominantly, I think whenever we actually discharge a patient, we actually tell them regarding personal protective measures. Actually, that is something that we can do ourselves and we don't need others to. And also something that we can do in the household and around.
Yes.
So personal protective measures is actually, especially in the, because we know they are day biters, at least in the morning times, wear full sleeve shirts or something which actually covers you fully. Use mosquito repellents. At homes, you use mosquito repellents, actually other the creams and other things like that. As well as net your windows and things like that. These are the common things that we will say on a community perspective, because especially that is very important. Because I think now, especially I think in Kerala, there's a new thing that has come up. Not a new thing, that is something that is coming up is the residents associations, at least in the cities, because cities is where we are finding it most. They are actually having this that's CAMS and actually a lot of Sevanavarams and things like that, where actually they can actually try and actually prevent the vector spread by actually making sure that coconut husks are taken off, or right. tires, and a lot of other areas where probably the vector can actually replicate can definitely be cut down. One interesting thing when I read up is actually something which has been employed in Indonesia, Singapore and other areas, where genetically engineered male mosquitoes are actually bred into the normal this one. So that is actually the wild type females, and thereby probably cutting the mosquito population.
Okay.
Also certain bacteria like Wolbachium actually has actually given, which actually has makes it resistant to dengue.
Okay.
So these are interesting concept. Hopefully if it will come into India, I think definitely it will be useful. Whether I don't know whether it will be possible in India at this particular stage. Okay.
So basically you have to clean the surroundings and keep your surroundings clean. Usually it will not harvest in the natural water. The artificial, whatever the things that has been thrown out of your house, after the rain they can come and lay eggs, and that is the time that when we see. So I think we have completed
water
our
coolers are the more
water coolers again.
People don't realize it is inside. They think high-rise buildings are immune.
Yes.
If you have water coolers there and water is stagnant there, then that is the beginning of the mosquito.
Okay, sir. So I think we have completed our pre-planned questions. Now we'll just go to the audience question. We have quite number. So since Abhrish is not here, I'll just start with. We have a lot of congratulatory messages from everyone. Why dextran cause coagulopathy and AKI? That is a question from Rahul. So
dextran is basically, it was used in hypotensive shocks previously. But the problem is dextran is, it's an artificial material. So anyway, this vascular component is leaking out from the vascular compartment. And it will remain there. If it is a simple IV fluid like normal saline, it can be absorbed. Even if you give albumin, it can be absorbed. But dextran will remain there, and especially in the lungs, it will go to the lungs and it will remain there. It will act like an ARDS. So dextran nowadays we don't.
Colloids.
It's a colloid. Colloid. But among colloid, only albumin is recommended.
Okay.
But albumin is very costly.
Okay. Then we have. Why fever is continuous for 7 days in dengue patient, that we have answered because of the pattern, and we'll be uploading in the evening. We'll again upload it as an YouTube session. NS1 sensitivity in febrile phases, again Anil sir has mentioned regarding the CART test and the ELISA test, so more will be towards.
If you get a CART test negative, repeat it after few days. ELISA.
Okay.
That's what we do here. Okay. We send the rapid CART test initially, which picks up NS1, IgG, IgM. If anything comes positive, immediately you treat. If something comes negative, after 1 week or 4 days, you
order. Repeat.
By default, everybody orders an ELISA. And we have a protocol of doing IgG, IgM together.
Together.
If it in case a secondary dengue, we immediately come to know that it's a secondary dengue.
Okay. Okay. When to give platelet transfusion, we have said. Again from Rahul, every patient should be evaluated for weakness and reflexes. They are indications for myositis.
Myositis will not produce weakness. It produces painful weakness. Not simple weakness. It's a painful weakness. You will not be able to examine the patient normally.
Okay.
Try to avoid this type of examination every day.
Every day.
When we are seeing first time, we can do all the clinical examination. Every day examining a patient who is having muscle injury will be... Very different.
Again, coexistent malaria, that depends upon your endemic area where you have both malaria and this thing. So peripheral blood smear again holds good as an initial investigation, and that should be your take home in this. Bacterial sepsis secondary to dengue, again in hospital infections, so routinely.
In some areas it is mentioned that this patient will be exposed to multiple things. They may take from food from outside, so they can have typhoid can be coexisted with many diseases. Or when they have dengue, because of low immunity, they can get a bacterial
infection.
So clinically, we have to assess and
treat the patient.
Yeah. Blood like the division, everything is possible.
Now, I have had an interesting case where actually a staphylococcus, actually methicillin sensitive staphylococcus infection, patient having significant focus in the spleen, the lung, A patient came into the ER actually quite bad, and even actually brain abscesses. And the only thing that was positive was actually dengue. Okay. So we send an immunoglobulin level because multiple level of patient is having this one. So I think the HbA1c at that time was actually 7, but after that subsequently patient never required steroids, insulin or any of anything of that mode. So there is definitely a immune deficiency which is happening at that particular time. Complicating things is actually the multiple IV lines and things like that you put, and that can cause the cephalogogous infection.
So once the patient is able to take orally, we can remove all the IV lines, and we are not more consistent regarding more of IV fluids. Fluids need to be given either orally, it's also fine for us. Any skin allergy due to dengue, but as we have said regarding the pruritus, so that is one thing that we have seen. Platelets we have said.
And usually that pruritus settles well with antihistamine, just like, and some emollient creams, that it just settles down here.
And vaccination in post-dengue patient that sort of clearly mentioned. Sepsis causes hypertension. Does vitamin K IM or IM is beneficial for bleeding manifestation?
Vitamin K is not beneficial for any bleeding manifestation other than absorption phase.
ADEK.
Like somebody is having obstructive jaundice, they have vitamin K deficiency. Vitamin K will be useful in them, but not in dengue fever.
Or otherwise, the patient is on vitamin K antagonist.
Definitely.
Not in
dengue fever, it is not present.
Okay. So, vaccine again, we have discussed role of steroid, role of antibiotics. Can dengue leptococcus? Yes, we have seen cases. Please remove mask for proper voice. Again, we are maintaining, trying to have some social distancing. So at least two of them who are close proximity have to wear the mask, because that is the, we are trying to end this pandemic. So that is the only way which we can continue. Risk of thrombocytopenia with reflexes in dengue. Again, we have covered the need of clinical investigation. Severe tiredness after dengue. So
this is common in all viral
or infection.
Even in the COVID, it is common.
Chronic fatigue syndrome.
NS1 and IgM and coexistent with Zika virus, or so something.
Zika is highly similar to dengue. If you have an IgM or IgG positive, it can be Zika also. So you have to do a plague neutralization test. That is not possible. In our setup.
Okay.
So that is the ideal method to differentiate whether it is Zika or dengue.
Okay.
But by default, we assume that whatever is here is dengue. But when Zika picks up, then we'll have a big problem differentiating which one is best.
Okay.
So cross-reaction is possible.
Yes, sir. So again, dengue is clinical manifestation associated with fever, thrombocytopenia. Transfusion criteria we have discussed. What about patients developing effusion and ascites due to leak? We should continue fluid resuscitation. So
fluid resuscitation is mainly for intravascular volume loss. It is a life-saving procedure. When the patient is in shock, whether the patient is having pleural effusion, ascites, we have to give fluid. But in when we talk about that, we have to talk in detail. So I am not talking. But albumin containing solution has a good choice in this type of patients who have already blood or the fluid has gone out, and there is a chance of going out. Albumin containing fluids like 5% albumin solution will be a good choice, but it is costly. So we are not discussing about that.
Okay, thank you, sir. Again, role of N-acetylcysteine in liver involvement in dengue. So, N-acetylcysteine, again, you can...
Specifically, the indication is only paracetamol. For paracetamol. All the rest that we are doing is actually off-label.
All for hepatitis, all hepatitis.
So, all the rest.
There is a decrease. We have seen some decreasing trend. Yes. But again, RCD itself, we do not know. For how many hours we can give fluid from Mayur Gaikwa? We can give fluid by 10 ml per kg if patient by ruling out myocarditis. So I think it is again depending upon the volume status of the patient.
Clinical assessment is required. Whenever you give fluid, you auscultate the patient, look for ultrasound, look for
output,
or leg raising test. Output is very, very,
very good.
So output will be the most important thing for any physician.
Okay. So, how many hours? What is dengue shock actually? What is the role of antibiotic? We have covered. Maybe Nagesh Gopals, you can just go back to the initial discussion. We have clearly discussed regarding this. Myeloid suppression treatment choice. So, again, the question will be like any role for drugs like Grafil, whether we have severe leukopenia. That is again not indicated to be given in dengue fever as such. So it's basically indicated for our oncological drugs, chemotherapeutic agents that is causing bone marrow suppression.
Actually, post that is where you should be. I mean, even for if you are evaluating a cause of pancytopenia, you should not be actually giving grafite.
Yes.
Because if it is a subleukemic leukemia or aleukemic leukemia, you are going to actually proliferate those cells and you are going to miss that particular diagnosis initially.
Definitely. So dengue IgG with long-term thrombocytopenia.
And
so
ITP we have seen in some dengue patients. We think that, assume that it is dengue may be positive. After 1 week, it is not recovering. So like Dr. Inna told, it can be a hematological malignancy. It can be more commonly an ITP. ITP is very, very common after any viral infection. So that should be kept in mind.
Okay. What about mild thrombocytopenia in some febrile patients, non-tropical, that what could be the cause? You have to, anyway, mild thrombocytopenia, you have to look for any other viral illnesses also. Any viral illness, they initially come with this thrombocytopenia. Papaya extract is being promoted in Tamil Nadu, but is it fake? That we have answered. We need more RCT, whatever meta-analysis has been described by Dr. Inna. I have seen many patients of dengue with ascites. Best indicated fruits, again, SARS covered. Normal saline, because availability, cost factor all together, and the indicated fruit will be normal saline. Pleural effusion causes sudden onset of breathlessness, fine. Hi Sabrish, you are here, very good discussion, thank you. Agas, they have good prognosis. Next live session is on which topics. Why we took dengue was, there have been a lot of cases and there has been a lot of requests in around India, and even there has been declared lockdown in certain areas outside India due to this dengue pandemic. So that is why we have taken this topic. So the next live discussion will be the topic of relevance at that point. So this was just decided on Saturday and we went live on this. How to manage fluid overload to our treatment, we have discussed. How to identify compensation shock and how to manage. Again, treatment of bradycardia and dengue. Bradycardia and dengue as a symptomatic bradycardia. Just like our patient is symptomatic, you have to go behind that bradycardia. Otherwise, just leave it alone.
Always follow ACLS protocol. Like you have a bradycardia, symptomatic, atropine will be the choice. But here, the problem is dengue, so you treat the dengue.
So for again, all other queries, you can note it our email ID, atcmacademy@gmail.com. If you have any personal doubts or anything that we have missed, you need to ask. Rather than the live session, you can come and email to us at atcmacademy@gmail.com. Can we still suspect dengue with dengue serology negative? Anil sir.
Yeah, it could happen. The wrong timing of the test. If you're putting an IgM in the first week, it won't come positive. If you're putting an RT-PCR in the second week, it won't come positive. When S1 after 14 days, it won't come positive. So you have to put the test according to the week
time frame.
So if you are still suspecting, go ahead with an IgG, IgM in the third or fourth week. It will come, both of them will come positive.
Okay.
And provided you have a high clinical suspicion.
Okay. So, sir, how to manage if there is respiratory involvement? Just like our stabilizing the airway breathing. So the respiratory involvement, it can be ARDS or it can be due to the pleural effusion.
Maybe it will be the choice emergency room. But it is not available, then oxygen mask.
So depending upon the oxygenation status, you can decide. Starting with your non-invasive ventilation.
Sometimes fluid overload also can be there because a lot of fluid might have gone. You have to remove it.
Remove it. Fine, sir.
Classics or something.
Okay, sir. How to manage, we have discussed. Sir, what is the, from the Shivam Dikshit, what is the protocol for leukopenia? Can we use antibiotic for prophylaxis against secondary infection? Again, we have covered. Routinely, if you're straightforward dengue infection, fine. But with other comorbidities, whenever you're suspecting anything.
I think if he is mentioning, looking about absolute neutrophil count being less than 1,000 or less than 500 impending absolute neutropenia, then probably the same routine protocol that we follow, I think, has to be implemented.
Febrile neutropenia. Yeah, if you are seeing a febrile neutropenia, we have to go behind that. But routine dengue case, it will usually recover. Nothing is needed. So go with your febrile neutropenia protocol. Discharge criteria. So again, the
discharge criteria, if you are looking at is actually whether the platelet recovery, I will not go behind the platelet recovery. The predominant criteria is patient has actually become better, patient has gone to the recovery phase and the complications associated with the recovery phase are not there. The platelet is even slowly rising, we do not need to actually hold back the patient.
Okay
if they have had no bleeding manifestation. As sir said, sometimes that can go into ITP, but then we'll have to give it a time. If he's a non-bleeder, even in ITP at platelet count 60 or 80,000, we are not going to treat at that particular point.
Okay.
So I think we can just wait.
Okay. So again, the questions to Giri sir, any new version book is coming up, sir. So that is the question.
We'll inform.
Definitely we'll inform. Is itching a significant worry? Yes, we have seen few cases. Dr. Rinaya already mentioned. Pruritus we have seen at the time of recovery. At how many platelets we can discharge the patient? There is nothing like that as such. We have clearly discussed the discharge criteria. What value of platelet infusion in case of single donor and different donor? It does nothing different. What is available with you? So if it is really indicated, what is available in your hospital, go with that. If it's a single donor or it's a multiple donor, whatever is available, you go with that.
Single donor will be costly.
Costly.
One time transfusion, single donor, we don't prefer because it's cost and other things.
Okay.
If you are multiple times in ITP and all, this will be preferred.
Okay. What value of platelet infusion in case of single donor we have discussed. After how many days of onset symptoms NS1 comes out positive? Again, question from Kaushik. So again, in the first week it will be the
NS1
usual
time. NS1 at the most 14 days 14. Will come positive. But once it is positive, there is no need to do a follow-up NS1.
Okay.
There is no need for follow-up
NS1. Okay, sir. Role of steroids again discussed. Discharge criteria, very good informative session. Thank you a lot. So that will be our last question. So any more questions, you can email to us at aetcmacademy@gmail.com. At this juncture, I would like to thank our panelists, Girish sir, Anil sir, and Dr. Rinaya for taking off of time from their busy schedule for being with us live for the last one and a half hours. Thank you, each one of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.